Well, what a great way to start our Palm Sunday service. So good to see you here. I'm going to invite you to stand as you are able, and let's enter into our time together. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Hosanna to God. Hosanna in the highest. The Lord is our strength and our might. The Lord has become our salvation. Hosanna to God. Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you. Well, again, good morning. Welcome again to this Palm Sunday service. We're so glad that you have chosen to be with us here in worship this morning. Welcome to everyone here in our sanctuary. Welcome, folks who are watching us online. We're so glad that you're a part of our congregation, whether you're with us live or later on in the day, later on in the week. We're glad you're a part of our celebration this morning. We're so glad to welcome everybody at the beginning of Holy Week. And because it is really our biggest week, it's the Super Bowl of church this week, Holy Week. So we got a lot going on. Let me mention a couple of those things. One is that starting tomorrow morning at 6:30, and then every morning through Friday, Monday through Friday, every morning over in our other building, we'll be having breakfast. At 6:30, our different Sunday school classes are providing hot breakfast and all kinds of other breakfast treats for us to eat. Then we'll have music, and we'll have each morning a different speaker who will be sharing a testimony and a word from Scripture with us. We'll kick off with Jim Owens, one of our great youth sponsors who's been a part of this church for a very, very long time. On Tuesday, Andrew Varvel, I've known him all his life, who's one of our youth directors. On Wednesday, Jeff James, who directs Restore Hope, that great ministry for greater Tulsa area. On Thursday, Sayun, our associate pastor. And on Friday, our former associate, James Hunt, who's now the director of the Wesley Foundation. If only we had a picture of him. Oh, we got the real thing right here. There's James Hunt right there. So, yeah, welcome, James. We're glad you're here today. So, he'll be back on Friday, yes. Yeah, and that's not just the OSU people clapping, okay, because he's the director of the Wesley down in Stillwater. James will be back here on Friday, but he's with us, of course, with his dad, David Hunt, who's our orchestra director, who's been out with health issues and back this week. We're so glad to see you as well, your whole family here today. The Hunts are here today. But anyway, that's happening Monday through Friday, and I'm not normally a morning person, but one week a year I am, and that's this week, and even if you're not a morning person, you'll be blessed if you come to eat and share in that Holy Week experience. That starts tomorrow morning. Now, as part of Holy Week, Thursday is a special day in many ways. Not only will we have our breakfast on Thursday morning, but that evening we'll be having a Maundy Thursday service. Maundy is comes from a Latin word that means mandate, as in Jesus gives a mandate at the Last Supper, a new command, a new mandate I give you that you love one another. That's why it's called Maundy Thursday. It's not Monday Thursday. A lot of people think, what's that even mean? Anyway, on Maundy Thursday, we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper with a service of communion and drama. We're going to have different people reading, doing dramatic readings about people who were at the cross witnessing the crucifixion. And so we invite you to come into our sanctuary at 6:30 in the evening. So 6:30 in the morning on Thursday, 6:30 in the evening on Thursday. And in between the breakfast and the service, all day long, we have Stations of the Cross, an experience that you can do anytime during that period between the two things. You'll start in the chapel, you'll go to different rooms, you'll have prayer, you'll have different scriptures. And you can do that right after breakfast, you can do it right before the service, or any other time during the day. At your own pace. And so that'll be happening on Thursday. And of course, folks at home, folks online, if you can't be here in person, we have packets available with the elements, the communion elements in them. You can come pick up, or if somebody here can take them to them if you pick one up today. I will mention that because it is, our staff is here at 6:30 or before every morning. This week, we do close our office at 3 o'clock in the afternoon every day this week. So just keep that in mind if you're coming by the church. So that's Thursday. Of course, next Sunday is Resurrection Day, Victory Day, our Easter services. Notice that as we've done for many years, we adjust our times just for that one Sunday to give us time for parking lots to fill and empty and all that kind of stuff. So our 8:30 service is going to be at 8. Our 9:45 service is at 9:30. And this service, you won't have to remember as hard. It's still at 11. But notice those times for folks coming on Easter morning, our different service times. The day before Easter, we have an opportunity for our men's ministry is providing a training event for UMCOR. UMCOR is the United Methodist Committee on Relief. And this is a training to be a responder in terms of disasters, a disaster response responder. It's a training for that that's from 8 to 4. And you can be available if in those, you know, when God forbid, but when a disaster strikes. I'm, of course, one of those agencies that whether we disaffiliate or not, we're going to continue to support UMCOR. So it's a great organization that's supported by many different denominations and things. So you can have training for that this coming Saturday. You can sign up for that or the next Servant Saturday. You can sign up for that as well, which is the following Saturday, the 15th. Some of our men will be going out and, again, serving in the community, giving some help to folks who just need a little bit of help. So that's coming up. You can sign up out in the out here at the desk for that. A couple other things. One is family camp is just about 3 weeks away. This is an overnight at New Life Ranch for elementary age kids and their families. Little siblings, older siblings, mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, anybody who would like to come as a family with our elementary kids for this overnight at New Life Ranch, which is a beautiful, beautiful place. And the last announcement I have is a little bit further down the road, about a month from now, our third annual 5K put on by our youth ministry to support and raise funds for our summer mission trip. Every summer, our youth go on a mission trip out of state where they build wheelchair ramps and do light repairs and painting and all kinds of other things for residents who are either elderly or just unable to do things for themselves. And our youth group, as well as youth groups from all different churches and denominations around the country, converge to work during the day and worship during the night. And it's a great thing, but it's costly. Our students pay to go, but they don't pay the full cost. We try to raise money to supplement that cost. And this is one of the fundraisers to supplement the cost of our youth mission trip. So you can sign up. There's a card out there. You'll see some. And the theme is sports, as in where, when you're running or walking, like I'll be trotting, wear your favorite team, sports team's jersey or shirt. And just to give you about one more little bit of info about that, just watch the screen for a minute. Know Emily was so talented, did you, in so many ways. Suspicious, she looked a little different a couple of those shots, but let me invite our kids to come up for our children's time. Scoot this over a little bit. Well, good morning, guys. Thanks for participating and waving the palm branches, which is what people did way back on the first Palm Sunday when Jesus came in to Jerusalem, and they were waving the palm branches, which was kind of like a flag. It was a way of saying, hooray for Jesus, and that word, Hosanna, right, that we shouted, Hosanna, which means save us, but it also just kind of means, yay, praise God, hip, hip, hooray. Now, let me ask you something. There are some places where you have to be quiet, right? Where are places you have to be quiet? Where's a place you have to be quiet? At the library, right? Where's another place you have to be quiet?
During church.
Yes. Right. When somebody's talking at church, it's nice to be quiet when somebody else is talking. Yeah. What's it? Maybe one or two other places where you should be quiet. Oh, when your dad goes hunting, he has to be quiet. He doesn't scare the deer, right? Okay, one more. A movie theater. Very good. Now, where's the place where you're supposed to be loud? Where's the place to be loud? Like in a bowling alley when you make a strike? Okay, where's another place to be loud? Do you know a place to be loud? Yeah, uh-huh. Outside? Yeah. One more. What? At a gathering place? Yeah. Where else can be loud? In a basketball game. Or, okay, what else? Okay, you think about it. All right, what else? At Disneyland, on the ride. Right? Okay, this has to be the last one. What? In a Billy Rigger. You remembered now. What was it? On a roller coaster. Okay, so now, put your arms out for a minute. All right. So normally, church, we kind of have to be quiet a lot of the time in church, don't we? Like when I'm talking or when the choir's singing or whatever, sometimes we have to be quiet in church. But today, I want to do something different. When I tell you, I want you to be loud. Not yet, okay? I want you to be loud because I want us to say Hosanna three times, okay? And when we say it, I want us to yell it. I don't usually tell you to yell in church. This is just today, okay? Just today. Okay, I'm going to count to three, and then we're going to shout Hosanna three times, okay? Ready? Are you ready to shout Hosanna three times? One, two, three. Hosanna! Hosanna! Okay, that was a little muddled. Let's do it kind of all together, okay? Let's do it like this. We'll do Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Okay, we'll do it kind of like the choir did it. All right, ready? Let's try one more time. Ready? One, two, three. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. All right, very good. Because, yes, we're excited. It's okay to be excited about Jesus, isn't it? It's okay to be excited. And once in a while, just like when you're in a football game and you're yelling, yeah, it's okay to be excited like that about Jesus, isn't it? Okay, let's pray about that. Lord, thank you for Palm Sunday. Thank you for this amazing Holy Week that we're starting. And thank you most of all for sending Jesus to show us how to feel joy and love and happiness and leading us to all the good truth about you, God. We just ask that you'd watch through us this whole week as we get ready next Sunday to celebrate the greatest day of all, Resurrection Day. Amen. I want to invite everybody to sign in on one of our communication cards that should be in the pew rack in front of you. We like to know who's here. We'd love to register your attendance here. And on the flip side, there's a way for you to share prayer concerns or joys. Somebody that's in the hospital, somebody that's going to have surgery, somebody who's lost a member of their family, or an answered prayer. It's how we make up our prayer list. And you can indicate if you'd like it to be a part of the prayer list or if you'd like to keep it confidential with myself and Sayin. But we appreciate everyone filling out one of those cards and looking at your bulletin. There's a prayer list there. The weekly newsletter that you should get in your email every Wednesday has a prayer list on that as well. And we just invite you to make that a part of your prayer life. Let's go to the Lord in prayer now. Lord, in every instance, we love you. We honor and worship you. You are indeed King of Kings. We can't really fathom just how big you are. When we try to look up at the stars, we understand that sometimes what we see in the sky is not just a star, it's a galaxy. And we understand the billions of stars and that you made every one of them. It's too big for us to really understand just how big you are, your power, your majesty. And yet, Lord, you know every single person on earth inside and out. You know our hearts. You know us by name. You made us and fashioned us in our mother's wombs. Lord, that knowledge is just too much for us. We can't really fully comprehend it, but we can only fall down in worship and awe and give you all glory and our thanks for being not just a powerful God, but a righteous God and a loving God who calls us your children, who calls us sons and daughters, and that we can call you Father. So hear the needs and cries of our hearts, the people that we're concerned about, people who need your healing, who need your restoration, who need your comfort, your strength, your wisdom, your guidance, people who need you in an immediate way. We lift them up to you in our hearts now. And we lift up our own lives, our own families and friends. We lift up that prayer that Jesus has taught us when he said, pray like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand as you're able for the reading of the scripture. Today's reading is from Luke chapter 19, verses 29 through 40. As Jesus approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They replied, 'The Lord needs it.' They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' 'I tell you,' he replied, 'if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out.' This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray together. Lord, once again, as we come to your written word, as we come as your people, your children, we ask that you would send your spirit of truth to inspire us, enlighten us, guide us, that the words of my mouth and the meditations and thoughts of all of our hearts and minds together would be pleasing and acceptable, Lord, in your sight. For Lord, you're our rock, you're our redeemer. Amen. If you're a parent or a grandparent, there's a good chance that at some point in your life, you were a football parent, or a baseball parent, or a basketball parent, or a cheerleading parent, or a gymnastics parent, or a wrestling parent, or a golf parent, or some other kind of event where you would go and support your child in a tournament, or a game, or a competition of some kind. Janine and I, for 7 years, were band parents, which meant that all three of our children were in the Pride of Broken Arrow, Broken Arrow's high school's marching band, which is the grandest band in all the land. And if you've ever seen the Broken Arrow marching band, you know they are really, really good. They are an exceptional marching band. And so we traveled often with the marching band to band competitions, including the Super Bowl of band competitions, which is the Grand National Championships held each year in Indianapolis, Indiana. And in 2006, we were in Indiana, and where our daughters, Patty and Lainey, as well as our future son-in-law, Andrew Darris, were in the band that year, and Broken Arrow won its first national championship. Then in 2011, when our son Andrew was in the Pride, Broken Arrow Marching Band won its second national championship. They've won twice since then. They've won a total of 4 national championships. And both the times when our kids were in the Pride, you know, the finals of the national championships are on a Saturday night in Indianapolis. Then Sunday, the band travels back to Broken Arrow. And what would happen on Sunday evening is the parents and the siblings and the friends and the grandparents and anybody else would gather in the parking lot of Broken Arrow High School to wait for the buses to pull in with the national champions with their Eagle trophy. And so, you know, there'd be cars lined up, there'd be banners, there'd be flags, there'd be flowers, there'd be signs. And then finally, you would see, you'd hear, there, here come the stream of buses headed towards the parking lot. And when the stream of buses headed towards the parking lot, the people would start honking their horns and flashing their lights and cheering and welcoming the national champions. And it was a big hoopla, which is probably pretty much like the parade in Kansas City when the Chiefs won the Super Bowl. I mean, it would be similar. I mean, it would probably be about the same as that in terms of the level of excitement. And so that is the closest I've ever come to a Palm Sunday-like arrival. Never been in a city which had a World Series champ or a Super Bowl champ. I have been there when the marching band national champs arrived. And that is the closest thing I've experienced probably to what it was like on Palm Sunday when Jesus came into town, when Jesus arrived in Jerusalem. It was not so much a victory parade as it was a celebration of hope and expectation. Because after 3 years of ministry, after Jesus traveling from village to town all around Galilee and all around Judea, after 3 years, Jesus had gained a reputation. There were stories about Jesus that had spread all through Israel. He's a miracle worker. I heard he could heal people. He healed a blind man, gave him sight. He healed a deaf man and allowed him to hear again. He cured lepers. A man whose legs wouldn't work, he allowed him to walk and run and jump. And he cast out demons. And not only that, I heard he walked on water one time. That he could control the weather, the waves and the wind. And I was there when he fed all of us. There were thousands of us. He fed us from just one sack lunch. And his teaching is like none we've ever heard. And the rumors and the stories about Jesus had permeated the crowds which had piled into Jerusalem for the Passover festival. This was the biggest holiday of the year for the Jewish people. It was the Passover celebration that was the celebration of the Jews coming out of bondage in Egypt when God delivered them out of the hand of Pharaoh. And that was the biggest party, the biggest religious festival of the year. And so Jerusalem was full of people. And word spread that Jesus, the miracle worker, Jesus was coming. And they were using the M word to talk about him, Messiah. Messiah. They thought, finally, this was the one who would deliver Israel out of bondage. That this was the one who would come just like his ancestor, King David. That he was the king that they'd been waiting for. And there was a high level of anticipation for Jesus. And so when he finally arrived, he comes into town and he's not riding on a horse. In ancient times, if a king arrived riding on a horse, it meant he was a warrior king, getting ready to brandish the sword and conquer. But the symbolism of Jesus was he came on a donkey, which was symbolic of a king arriving in peace, a king of peace. So Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey, and he fulfilled the words of the prophet Zechariah. For Zechariah had written in Zechariah 9:9, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Rejoice greatly. Shout, daughter. Yeah. Shout, daughter. Shout, son. Shout, mom. Shout, dad. Shout, grandma and grandpa and little kids. They were all shouting and praising and yelling and waving palm branches and putting their coats on the road for him to ride on top of. And they were yelling out things like, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." They were shouting things like, "Welcome, son of David. that he was the descendant of the great King David, and often they were just shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna," which literally means "save us." But it had come to mean really kind of a general shout of praise, a hallelujah, Hosanna, Hosanna. So everybody's pumped up. The crowd is excited. There's joy and anticipation. It's like a big parade party. Everybody's excited. Well, no, not everybody's excited. The religious authorities were not excited. The Pharisees, the ultra-religious group, was not excited. The priests were not excited. The members of the Sanhedrin, the religious council, the religious leaders were not excited. They were concerned. They were worried. They were troubled. They were actually getting madder and madder, doing a slow burn, because they too had heard about Jesus. But they'd heard the miracle stories, but what they'd also heard troubled them. They'd heard he was a rebel. They heard that he was a troublemaker, an agitator, a rabble-rouser, an outsider who was not part of their official training program. They heard that even though he was still in his early 30s, he dared to criticize them. That Jesus criticized the religious establishment. That Jesus criticized the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the priests. He called them blind guides. He called them snakes and vipers. He called them hypocrites. And they feared, the religious leaders feared, that the cheers of the crowd and the excitement of the crowd was dangerous. Dangerous. They didn't like the crowd being so enamored of this man from Nazareth. And so, as Jesus comes and the people are joyfully shouting, the religious leaders call out to him, "Rabbi," a name they probably grudgingly used for him, "Rabbi, rebuke your disciples." Translation, tell them to shut up. Tell them to sit down and be quiet. Tell them this is inappropriate. Tell them to settle down. Tell them to be quiet. And here's how Jesus responds to that. Luke 19:40, he says, "I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." The stones will cry out. I've been talking about stones for several weeks, stones and rocks. He says, the stones will cry out, which you wonder what that would have really looked like. I think Jesus is being symbolic here. I think he was saying, you can't tamp down this excitement. You know, you can't. It's in the air. It's in the atmosphere. This excitement and this joy can't be contained. You can feel it all around you. You can feel it on your feet. You can feel it from the very pavement, this excitement and anticipation. This kind of excitement and joy is contagious. Well, that's what the authorities were worried about. They were worried that it was contagious. They were worried that this exuberant joy and faith would catch on to more and more people, and that's what worried them. They worried this excitement was like a virus that needed to be stopped, and that's why they said, rebuke your disciples. Tell them to be quiet. Tell them to close their mouths. Tell them to shut up. You know, a lot of people in the 2,000 years since then, a lot of people have been telling followers of Jesus to sit down and shut up ever since. A lot of times, people who follow Jesus have been told, "Settle down, just calm down. Don't be so excited. Don't get carried away." One of those people was John Wesley. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement. John Wesley, the one who started this whole thing that we call Methodism, that I have lived my whole life, that I love so much. This Methodist movement that Wesley started. You see, Wesley grew up as the preacher's kid and grew up thinking he'd be a preacher too, and he was. He went through all the schooling and became a priest in the Church of England. But it wasn't until years after his ordination that he had a a moment where God just filled him with a warmth and a glow and a power and an energy where he came to experience the love of God in a new and fresh way. And it changed him. It changed his preaching. It made him excited about Jesus. It made him full of a desire to see other people to come to Jesus. And he started to preach with this vigor and this power. And the religious leaders of the Church of England did not like it. They didn't like it. They called Wesley one of the worst names you could call a preacher. They called him an enthusiast. That was a dirty word in the Church of England in the 1700s. An enthusiast, it meant you were just getting carried away. You were being too emotional. You were being too excited. In the Church of England, the preachers were supposed to talk in a nice, calm voice and never really change the timbre of the voice. Just allow people to take the naps in the pew that they had come for. They didn't like Wesley's exuberance, so they called him an enthusiast, and he was not welcome in church after church. They closed the door on him. They called him an enthusiast, and he realized the church wasn't open and welcoming of the common people anyway. So he started to preach in the byways and the roads and the street corners and the fields and the town squares. And preach with enthusiasm. He didn't care that they called him an enthusiast, and they kept some of the other pastors and priests actually threw tomatoes at him, and worse, because his style of excitement and preaching just wasn't very British, and it wasn't proper for a clergyman. His denomination, the Church of England, didn't want people getting that excited about Jesus. His denomination didn't want people getting that excited about Jesus. I was reading a little article by a man named Steve Molin. Steve is a Lutheran pastor up in Minnesota. And before he became a pastor, he was a youth director. He worked in youth work. And he talked about how much he enjoyed taking young people and seeing them at youth camp. Because, of course, Lutherans have youth camp too, just like Methodists. And he would be at youth camps, and he would be so encouraged by seeing what would happen at a week of youth camp, how these young people, these teenagers, these middle school and high school students would maybe catch this excitement about Jesus, how maybe for the first time in their life it would really, really resonate with them that this is something to get excited about, that the worship would be loud and raucous and go on, and the students would get up after a couple of days and start giving testimonies about how Jesus had changed them and touched their lives, and he saw young people get excited about their faith and about Jesus, and it was encouraging to him, and it warmed his heart, and he loved to be in that atmosphere where young people were excited about their faith. And he said he had one young man that was there at the youth camp who got really excited about his faith. And he couldn't wait at the end of the week to go back and tell everybody about Jesus and tell everybody about his experience. And the first person this young man wanted to tell was his Lutheran pastor back home. So the young man went to his Lutheran pastor and started to tell him about his experience at youth camp. And his pastor's response was, "What a bunch of nonsense. You've already been baptized and confirmed. You don't need all this other silly stuff. Remember, you were already in confirmation. You don't need all this other stuff." God help that pastor. God help his church. God help that young man who had his balloon pricked by a pastor who long had since believed that enthusiasm had no place in the ministry. God help them all. What a travesty. God help any church where joy, the joy of the Lord, is squelched, where enthusiasm and excitement is a flaw. You know, after Palm Sunday, the day after Palm Sunday, Jesus got pretty fired up himself. On that Monday, he was in the temple, and he saw in the outer courts of the temple people being flat out swindled in the name of God. People being cheated in the name of the Lord. People who were coming to worship and they had their offering to put in the temple treasury, their coins. And they were told, oh, that's Roman money. We can't accept that dirty old Roman money. You got to exchange your Roman money for temple money. And here's the exchange fee that you need to pay. You saw people bringing their animals, their goats and lambs for sacrifice in the temple. And they were told, oh, that lamb has a crooked leg. There's a blemish right there on his side. You can't bring that in for sacrifice. You need to buy an officially approved lamb from the official booth over there at 3 times the market price. And of course, all that money from selling the animals at 3 times market price and all that fee from money changing, all that went into the pockets of the high priest because he owned the booths and he owned the money changers. It was all a scam. It was all a racket. And it made Jesus' blood boil. And so Jesus, he wrote a strongly worded letter. Dear sir, I cannot believe. No, he didn't do that. He didn't write a strongly worded letter. He got a whip. He got a whip and he started turning over their tables and yelling at them, and he drove them out of the temple courts with a whip. Jesus' disciples remembered that day, and later on they remembered a verse from Psalm 69. Lord Almighty, zeal for your house consumes me, and the insults of those who insult you fall on me. Jesus had zeal for the house of the Lord. It consumed him, this zeal. He said to these money changers and sellers, he said, you've taken God's house, the house of the Lord, and turned it into a robber's den. A den of thieves. His love for the house of the Lord consumed him. And he drove them out of the temple courts. And of course, that sealed Jesus' fate right there. I mean, he had just insulted the high priest himself with that action. If they had any doubt about Jesus needing to die before that day, they were firmly convinced after that little episode, yes, Jesus must die. We have got to find a way to kill him without starting a riot. We've got to kill this man. And so they began to plot and scheme and figure out how they could get Jesus quietly away from the crowds and kill him. Because he was a threat. He was a threat to the religious authorities' power and control. Those who were in power, the religious authorities, were threatened by those who would question their power and control. Now, what happened over the next few days is what we talk about over the next few days of Holy Week. Jesus teaching in the temple every day, right in plain sight, right under the noses of the religious authorities who were seething, waiting for some way to get him away from the crowds. And they would come and they'd challenge him and argue with him and try to pose a question that would stump him. And every time they failed. Jesus taught day after day in the temple. On Thursday night, he and his disciples gathered in an upper room to celebrate the Passover. He washed their feet. He said the bread represented his body and the cup, his blood. They went to a garden, the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus began to pray, and he prayed so fervently, asking that if there's some other way, Lord, he prayed so fervently that he sweated blood. Until Judas, one of the 12, came with a mob, and he was arrested and taken to the house of the high priest, put through the mockery of a show trial in the middle of the night, accused of being a blasphemer, found guilty, slapped and spat upon, taken to the Romans where he was beaten and whipped with thorns pressed into his forehead, and finally taken outside the city gates to the execution spot called Golgotha, where they killed him in the most painful and awful way possible. Until at 3 o'clock on Friday, they took his dead body down and placed it in an empty tomb, a borrowed. And that, as far as the authorities were concerned, was the end of Jesus. Now, we know there's more to the story. We know what happened on Sunday. We'll talk about that next week. But in the meantime, let's dwell on that moment on the Mount of Olives for a minute again. That when he started coming down, and I've been fortunate enough a couple of times in the Holy Land to actually travel that route that you get to go and experience what it was like for Jesus to come down the Mount of Olives, and people are jumping and cheering and waving and excited, and the authorities told him to be quiet, to shut up. There's times when we've been told or we've felt like we can't get too excited about Jesus. It just wouldn't be proper to get too excited about Jesus, to get too exuberant, to get too worked up about Jesus. But you know what? If we're not excited about a life with Jesus, why would we expect anybody else to be that is in contact with us? If we aren't excited about our faith, why do we think somebody else would be or could be? Because excitement is contagious. Faith is often not so much taught as it is caught. People catch our love for Jesus. Do you have an exuberant love for Jesus that others can catch? Do you have an excitement for the Lord that others could get excited about too? People are drawn to people who are excited. People who, you know, now that we have grandchildren, little grandchildren, my wife Janine, who takes care of them sometimes, you know, if she says to our little kids, you know, we're going to have raisins for a snack, they're like, raisins? Yeah! But they don't even know what a raisin is. But they can tell if she's excited about it, well, it must be pretty good. Raisins must be good if Nana's that excited about them. My grandson Leo, who's almost 3, he can tell how excited I get about Batman, so he likes Batman too, because excitement is contagious. Excitement is contagious. John Wesley, if you haven't figured out by now how much I love John Wesley and the beginnings of Methodism, John Wesley, one of my heroes, said this: light yourself on fire with passion, and people will come from miles to watch you burn. In other words, people are drawn to passionate people like a moth to the flame. We're drawn to people who are passionate, whether they're passionate about football or reading or shelter animals or marching bands or anything else. People are drawn to people who are passionate. We have a passion for Jesus. We have a passion for Christ. Are we willing to let that passion show? Don't expect the rocks to do it. That's our job. Lift our praise, our joy of the Lord, that others might be drawn to him as we've been drawn to him. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you thankful always for the love that we see in Jesus. We thank you as we follow this story once again, the story that we have been focusing on during Lent, this story that reaches its climax this week, that we might really once again comprehend how deep and wide and high is your love that came in Jesus, that came to us in his life, his death, his resurrection. Lord, help us to grasp the depth of your love and respond with worship and praise, and let that excitement show. We pray in your name. Amen. We have a time every week to give back to God. You may have noticed there's an extra envelope there in your pew rack. During Holy Week, we invite you to make a special offering above and beyond our normal offering if you'd like. We have a Holy Week special offering. Part of it will go to Restore Hope that I've mentioned. Jeff James will be here Wednesday to share with us a ministry that's supported by multiple different kinds of churches all over the Tulsa area that helps people in very significant ways. And our campus ministries, the ones like the one where James works at OSU, and the other campus ministries that help students find a place to worship and serve and grow in their faith. And those are ministries that we'll support. We've supported for all these years, and whether we disaffiliate or not, we'll continue to support. So if you'd like to make an offering for those, we invite you to do that in addition to our normal tithes and offerings, which pay the bills and do so much in the name of Jesus for our community and far beyond, that allow us to be the church that Jesus has called us to be. So So if our ushers will come, we'll receive God's tithes, our gifts and offerings to Christ and to his church. Let's pray together. Lord, for all you do for us, we're so thankful. We give back to you now. And we ask that you'd use what we give as a way to lift people up, as a way to help people see your love and your light, as a way that people would know there's a God of love who created them and loves them infinitely and more abundantly than we can conceive. Lord, bless it in your name. Amen. Good Friday, we're going to sing, "Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed?" And as we're singing, maybe if God's speaking to your heart during this Holy Week to just hear what he's calling you, something new, a new conversation you need to have with somebody, a new relationship you need to give some attention to, whatever God might be calling you to do this day or this week, I invite you to have an open mind and an open heart. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
I'll see a lot of everybody this week in the mornings, on Thursday evening, and obviously next Sunday on our wonderful Easter celebration. I invite James Hunt. Many of you know, who lived around here a few years back, and I'm going to invite him to close us out.
Receive this blessing. May the God who gave us life, the Christ who gave us love, and the Spirit who gives us courage carry us to this place so full of grace that we share life and love and courage with